40-year anniversary, and the first one was in 1978, and it was at Eden Prairie High School. Any coaches? I know one in here was there. Any other coaches at that clinic in 78? Some of you, most of you probably weren't born. I know we got one guy, Craig, was there, and Don Dorot from New Prague actually gave me the notes. And it's over there, the display committee, if you get a chance, make sure you thank them. They do a fabulous job. But anyway, if you get a chance, check that out, the speakers, and it was pretty cool. So let's get started with Billy Gurdon from Western Michigan. He enters his ninth season as the head coach of the Western Michigan Broncos. In 2016, Coach Gurdon led the Broncos to his first NCAA appearance in 27 years after winning the Mid-American Conference Tournament for the first time in school history. Gio mentioned Frank Ellis, and he's obviously the former Twins player, manager, radio announcer. But anyway, Frank Corsi is in the Western Michigan Hall of Fame. One thing before Coach Gurdon comes up, I went on the web, and Coach Gurdon doing a nice job, you know, interviewing, talking to the media. Then they went to the weight room, and I was, on my brain, I was thinking baseball, and then up on the wall they had roll the boat. Holy cow, we got a guy that rolls the boat. You know, Coach, if you're ready to go, maybe you could tell us a little bit about Coach Frank and working with him in baseball.
I somehow knew that that would not be missed. Is this, do you want me to tell you from here or come up on the stage?
You are on.
I'm on, okay. Let me start by thanking some people, the Minnesota High School Baseball Coaches Association, for extending this invitation to me. Like you, I personally love coming out to these things because I benefit from it from a professional development standpoint just by getting in there and getting my work prepared to try to help you get one thing from me today, or two things, hopefully more than that, or ask for a refund. Secondly, I want to thank Paul Twenge, a good friend of mine who used to be at Valparaiso University. He's now at Minnetonka. Congrats to him on being 4A Coach of the Year here in Minnesota. So third and last, I want to thank Jake Boss. Jake Boss is the head coach at Michigan State. He's been there, I believe, 11 years. My baseball career was just, if you knew where I came from as a kid to where I am now, you would probably be going, how in the world did this guy get here? But I had a lot of people help me. And I was fortunate enough to play in the Big Ten, coach in the Big Ten, and Jake Boss gave me an opportunity at Michigan State in 2009. I had been a head coach at IPFW in Fort Wayne, Indiana for 9 years, and it just wasn't going anywhere. I wasn't able to create the kind of resume to get the kind of looks that I wanted. Jake offered me an opportunity at Michigan State. I was there for 2 years, and it kind of, I don't want to say it, it's just kind of redesigned who I was in the eyes of those that might hire me. And my family is now in Kalamazoo, and I'm thankful for it. I just want to publicly thank him for picking me over a lot of guys that he could have chosen. Let's go to roll the boat. I would just tell you this, that PJ Fleck did an outstanding job at Western Michigan and took this team to the Cotton Bowl. I was lucky enough that my son said for his 16th birthday, all he wanted me to do was drive him to the Cotton Bowl. So I did. Got hip surgery because of it, but had a guy ask me earlier if I'm from Texas. I'm like, wow, I mean, the accent's a little strong, but it's not Texas, it's Southern Indiana. It's pretty bad, I get it. My kids don't have it, I don't understand it. It is a reflection on education, so go easy on me. But PJ did an outstanding job. It helped some identity with Western Michigan, although Western's a very, very good school. And some of the history of that, Frank Quillacy was mentioned. I'm a history guy, and I study Western Michigan's history, and it's tremendous in the fact that it's the home of the first ever College World Series, 1947. In this world of political climate that we live in, I tell recruits that everybody wins with the College World Series in Kalamazoo because it was between Yale and California. So on the Yale team playing first base was George Bush, the first Bush president. So the Republicans can celebrate. For the Democrats, he lost in 1947, they came back and he lost again in 1948. So we can start a climate of good discourse right here, right now, in the game of baseball. So the history, and then the World Series moved to Wichita in 1949, and then it went to Omaha in 1950. Western Michigan played for a national title in 1955 and got beat by Wake Forest 7-6 in the championship game. Bill LaJoy was on that team, the architect of the Tigers, the Doyle Alexander, John Smoltz trade that happened many years ago. He's since passed. And I've talked to all of these guys, which leads me up to the conversation that I had with Frank Quillacy when I called Frank and just said, you're an iconic figure here. I'm bringing the team to play John Anderson in 2013 in the Dome. Is there any way you can come over and meet the team? And he did. And Frank came over, had breakfast with us. He talked to the team. He and I kept some communication as we went on, but the history of his career is spectacular from on the field to in the booth. So that's a little bit about Western Michigan University. Our baseball program has been there for over 100 years. Some unique things about Western, and I'll get into the presentation here, is that we've had more draft picks than any other MAC school since the draft instituted itself in 1965. I've been at Western, this is my ninth season, and the last 5 years in a row we've had a junior taken, at least one junior taken every year, and a few of those was two. And this, what I'm gonna do today, proper pen plan prevents poor performance, because I wanna do a lot of P's up here for you, is that it ties into the recent draft pick that we had named Nick Leo, who was a junior last year. He was our number one guy. He was a very late developed, under-recruited, preferred walk-on guy, no money. Kind of even wondered, maybe should we have recruited this guy? And he was our number one pitcher last year and was drafted by the Texas Rangers in the 20th round. He signed for over $100,000, and all of our guys are going, how'd that happen? So to his credit, his God-given ability, his work ethic, and then I honestly believe that this pen structure isolated on his strengths and helped him be a better draft. I think he would have been anyway, but he's a good student of the game, so I'm going to talk about that a little bit as we go through. Where do we start? This is Keegan Akin. We've all got that one player. Keegan was the 54th pick overall in 2016. We ended up at the Louisville Regional playing the number two national seed. A lot because of him. He helped us win our first MAC tournament championship game. We beat Kent State in the final game 12-7. He pitched that game. He went the first six innings on 3 days rest, allowed no runs. But in my third presentation on Sunday, I'll tell you why he went on that Sunday, and it's because we took care of his arm. We never ever asked him to pitch, and we don't ask our starters to pitch other than on their day that they're supposed to pitch. Exceptions to all rules, but that's our general rule. So this is kind of our poster child. It's the third highest draft pick in the school's history. It was the highest draft pick since 1970. He signed for $1.2 million. He was just named the Eastern League Pitcher of the Year, AA, and then the Orioles named him the Jim Palmer Minor League Pitcher of the Year. He's fast-tracking without a question. So that's Keegan. And nobody was recruiting Keegan. We offered him 30%, and he developed in our program. So the unique thing about our draft picks is that none of them were drafted before they got to Western. So we're proud of that development. I love quotes, and this is what this presentation is going to be about, simplify to amplify. My accent kind of fits who I am. I like things really simple. I like cheeseburgers. I like chocolate ice cream. I like pizza. Start getting crazy in the kitchen, I'm not interested. So that's kind of how I coach. And somebody said 6'5", 280. I was sitting over there thinking, damn, I wish I was 6'5". So, not 280. It's too close, I'll tell you that. But anyway, simplify to amplify. The goal of all of our pitchers is to get ahead in the count. This is not just lip service. This is what we structure everything around. We structure everything around the first pitch. And I'm going to give you some reasons why. and then we want to stay ahead. This is taken from Major League Baseball. I think it was 2016 when I pulled these. It's probably not much different now, other than there's probably more strikeouts and more home runs. But these are counts from Major League Baseball in 2016 when a hitter was in an 0-2 count, he's hitting 118. I'll take that. In a 1-2 count, hitting 151, a 2-2 hitting 169, 0-0 counts are hitting 186. So that tells me that, hey, you got eight guys behind you, stick it in the zone. 0-1 count, still got great batting averages that favor us defensively. 1-1, watch as it goes up. So the difference in going to this from this is incredible. So we build from the ground up on the first pitch, and then the next three, or the next two, for three total, because that's what we're trying to get, is in that 1-2 count. And then we build a pen off of those counts, learning how to finish hitters when we don't get in that. 3-1, we don't want to be there. And then for whatever reason, that's one of the strongest counts. I noticed I didn't put them up, but in my next presentation, I think I have them all. The 3-2 is not that high of a count, a batting average. And it's probably because guys are nibbling, trying not to stick it in there, afraid to be hit, whatever. But you can see those counts. No, I'm sorry, 2-0 was the highest batting average at 386. I mean, that's a big, big number. Types of pins. FPS, anybody want to guess what that stands for? First pitch strike, and then 1-2-3. That's what we're focused on, the first three pitches, one at a time, though. So this is a blanket approach. Every single pitcher does this type of a pin. We're going to have custom pins, which is our sequence pin that follows the first three concept, and that is working and finishing the count. What am I going to throw in that 1-2 count? What am I going to throw in that 2-2 count? And that's custom created to the pitcher. Last year, I got very involved in the pitching because I pitched at IU, and I was a overachiever. Was not a draft pick, although, like many of your players, thought I was. But my parents didn't. But I'm sure you don't have any parents that think you guys are draft picks. You know the sarcasm? Just think. And then we have mastery pens. Mastery pens are individually driven. Last year I took over pitch calling. Just wanted to see what happened. And my pitching coach, he's great, I love him. But he would say, Coach, this is the sixth changeup in a row. And I would say, I know, it's really good. And he hadn't hit it. And I just want to see how bad he looks, because he's in the box afraid I'm going to do it. He's begging me to throw something else. So I'm not afraid to get exotic and pitch calling whatsoever. So back to our blanket approach. First pitch strike, 1-2-3. Preliminary, routine for all. So this is what we do as we get loose. So I used to make the mistake early in my coaching career, hey, let's get loose. Guys are just throwing. But the devil's in the detail, so we're trying to cross our T's and dot our I's. So the guy comes up and he's getting ready to get loose. He knows what his pen is. He knows why he's doing it. And it's structured to help him throw more strikes. Can we reset that? I hit the wrong button there. Thank you. So it's going to start with an extend fastball. I call it the sand wedge. It's also glove side. You think about your pitchers that you have, most of them miss arm side. Miss arm side, they hit guys, they get blocked out. We do too. So we start the pin working against that and forcing glove side extension. So we go to the driving range, what we love to do, we love to get the driver, bang, 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 bang. This is the sand wedge. Let's start working the short clubs and then we'll work in to the big clubs. That's a get me over. Then we go in, and then we're going to repeat that routine with off speed. And here's an example. This is our preliminary fastball routine. This is Chris. He's going to be in our rotation this year, big lefty. And you can watch the catcher slide off the plate and see he's pulling out across, extending this fastball. So this would be a double or triple bump, almost an unhittable pitch. And it's forcing him to get out and get down out front right now. Then he's going to move in. Now these are get me overs. So now he's working on it. So you think about it as a run. Sometimes we say, hey, around the horn. So it's just like shooting. So we start away, fastball. Then we go middle with the fastball. Hopefully he'll give you one in here. Thank you. And now he's coming in. So this is against the left-handed hitter. Doing a good job. I gave him a sandwich for helping me out. And now he's going to go back in. I don't know why we switch catchers. Oh, that kid loves attention, and he knew we were filming, so he got it. Okay, so now that he's got a feel for that, this is his preliminary fastball round. Off that, we go to off speed. This is the preliminary breaking ball round. Now he's going to go same concept, but he's creating the chase breaking ball. Not to get me over and not to beat me, but to chase, getting out there where we need to execute pitches. Then he's going to drop them in, 1-0 mentality, 0-0 mentality, 3-1 mentality. I went away from corners, and everything is white plate mentality, unless we're better than 2-2. Once we get to a 2-2 count, we're pitching to the white, we're staying off the corners. Because we want to force guys into the count that we want, and we want to force action for our defense. I think one of the things I'm most proud of since I've been at Western is 8 seasons. 1 year we broke the school record, and we were 11th in the nation in fielding at 978. That just so happened to be the year we went to the NCAA tournament, and I don't think that's a coincidence at all. As good as Keegan was, the defense, we lost a lot of 1-0 ball games early, so we were in the MAC tournament, under 500. We ended up in the NCAA tournament under 500. But early in the year, we were losing 1-0, 2-1. The offense was just not going, and it caught on fire in conference, and we rolled. But the defense was very, very consistent. Okay, this is what this is just a snapshot of the chart. So we start out. FPS, it's about 12 pitches. It's the preliminary round I just talked about. Fastball's away, middle in, breaking ball's away. You know what, I forgot to show you that. At the very end here, with the breaking balls, he finished off with bouncing breaking balls. I don't know if you saw that. So it's okay. He rolled through, chase me's, get me overs, beat me's, and then bounces. And then we would go back through and do it with a changeup too. But the changeups are almost always get me overs. That's throw them down the middle and let them do their thing. So we don't get too crafty with the changeup most of the time. We have two guys with plus changeups. It's their pitch, and they can command it, and we do start plucking and picking corners with it. But Chris has got a really good change. Doesn't have a lot of movement, it's just got plus arm action, so everything he does with the changeup is get me over mentality, let it work, put it in play. It's a hit me pitch, not a beat me pitch. So back to this pin structure, when we first pitch strike, they know they're going 12, and that's the delivery is that's their preliminary work. And usually it's all from the windup or stretch. They can do whatever they want there to get the feel for that, but they have to do a little bit of both. I don't care how they start it. Some guys we have only throw from the stretch, so that makes it simple. But over 50% of the pitches that we threw last year were from the stretch, so we do a lot of work in that area. So then we go to the 1-2-3, and it's 5 sets of 3, and it's a mix. And then we'll go to we'll stay in it, and then we'll go to the stretch, and then we're timing the pitcher every single pitch. So we're working on his delivery time to the plate within the pen. So the person that's sharding has a watch, and he calls that guy's timeout every single time, 1-3. And he knows I need to go faster. So we're trying to get in between a 1-1-5 and a 1-2-5. 1-3 can be okay, but I want it lower. Then we're gonna take, I'll show you the chart here, and then we chart everything at the end. When they're done, we walk up and show them, here, here's what you did first pitch. This shows my age and my lack of technology. Can I just expose myself here and say I had to take a picture of this thing and then transfer it on here? I don't even know how I got it on here. Is it visible? I could not pull it from a shared drive and nothing, but it looks okay. So maybe I shouldn't have told on myself. But this is our chart. This is our lifeblood. I don't even care about anything else. And you can see where the green is. The green's on the most important pitch in baseball. It is at Western, and that's the strike one. And then the next two, that's their focus two. So Gene mentioned earlier, he was talking about focus. We have a goldfish, or I have a goldfish. I keep it on the back of a clipboard. Because I'm big on 3 seconds of burst concentration. So hitters are trying to burst for 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. Pitchers are trying to concentrate for 3 seconds and to relax. If you think about it, the game is really nothing but a bunch of 3 second action. So we're putting our focus on that, but the goldfish, I was trying to explain to our guys, if we can get some focus, they know that they gotta be able to define it, that it's clarity of vision, clarity of understanding. So I'm Googling it, and everything that's on Google is true, right? It's on the internet. And a goldfish popped up. So I clicked on it. And it started talking about the ability of teenagers to concentrate pre-iPhone. And it was like 17 seconds, unless it was about their girlfriend Cindy, that they could concentrate without breaking off into something. Now, it's down to around 12 since the iPhone came in. And it said that a goldfish could concentrate for 11 seconds. Who's doing that job? After a 7-game losing streak, I'd like to interview for it, to be honest with you. So I told our guys, if we can't beat a goldfish, we can't win. So all it is just a thing on the back of my clipboard when we make mistakes, or better yet, when we make back-to-back mistakes. I just hold it up, and it's just a reminder of focus, concentration, being in the moment. So we'll go hitter number one, and then we'll go alternate, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. We'll put a live hitter in, or I call it the zealot, which is the proper pitch dummy. We always try to have something in there, an object of some type. So there go three pitches. So it might be fastball. Try to stay in the fastball early. Strike one. If it goes breaking ball, so now we're in 0-1. Now we might go a beat me breaking ball, which is not giving the play away, but we're trying to put that breaking ball in the corner. So it's white to black, instead of dumping it in center cut. Now we're at 1-1. If we miss, now we're probably gonna go right back to the fastball and jam it right in there, or a changeup right in the middle. But I want our guys to know, don't get outside of a 1-2 count. Now, there are hitters that will come up in situations that we do nibble around. And I think last night, where they do walk bets late, right, not gonna pitch to that, whatever. There are situations where you're not trying to get into a 1-2 count with an open base, their best hitter, somebody that's 10 for 10 for the weekend. But we run through, and then we'll give the guys their percentage of first pitch strikes. So this is typically 9, 3 pitches, it's 27 in the fall. It might be 5 in the spring when we're getting ready, it might be 15. So if they do 5 hitters, they're 5 for 5, that's great. And then they get a percentage of how many of they got 2 out of 3 strikes. And then we calculate those statistically, we post those, we email it to, and let them see them so that they know we think this is the most important thing going on, regardless of ability or secondary stuff. Put us in this count, get the ball in play, eliminate free bases. Eliminate free bases and keep guys from sitting in there at 3-1 that are hitting 386 in the big leagues. Sequence pen. Preliminary warm-up, it's the same. So now when we move to an advanced pen, this will be more custom to the guy and his stuff. We'll stay with the preliminary warm-up, and it might be whatever he needs, 6, 7, 9, 12, and then we'll roll from that, which I just showed you, into our sequence pen. We're still pitching to the white part of the plate until 2 strikes. We get to 1-2, now we're going to be working on beat me with pitcher strengths. We're not throwing in a 1-2 to try to get to a 2-2. We're not nibbling. We're not tentative. We're aggressive with our stuff in our count. 0-2, work on chase me's. 0-2, depending on the hitter, and most of the guys in the MAC and in the Big Ten that we play, we don't want to just jam an 0-2 in there with a get-me-over mentality. And this is where we were able to take Nick Leo to another strength. The Texas Rangers were able to use hip tracks when they were evaluating Nick. We don't have it. It's only 50 grand. I'll be sending a tray around. But the Rangers had Nick, out of all their draft prospects, he had the farthest extension down the slope at 6'5", 225. We didn't even know it. I knew it had a good, loose, long arm. But what we did is we started pitching up in the strike zone. And I'll be honest with you, I got it from watching the Houston Astros World Series run and watching those guys pitch up in that zone. And guys were missing the fastball that technically was a strike or maybe a ball above the strike zone. Where you might think, man, that's a blank shot. But it's, you know, when you got Evaldi or whatever throwing 101 and he blew Turner up last night, that's a different story. But if you've got a guy that's got firm velo in respect to what you're competing against, that elevated fastball is magic. It's magic. And then we're focusing on the bottom half of the strike zone. So I told you we had the highest fielding percentage, 11th in the nation in 2016, but four of the years that I've been at Western have been the highest fielding percentages ever recorded at Western in 100 years of baseball. So our defensive routine, I'm really the infield coach, and I just dabbled into the pitching last year to see if I could get our strikeouts up, which they went up. The highest strikeout to nine ratio in 10 years and the lowest batting average against in 12 years. And the best ERA in the last 4 or 5 years. And it was just this. Here's the sequence. So they're going to go preliminary versus a right-hander, about 10 to 12 pitches, charted on the similar chart that you saw. It just doesn't have the that it doesn't stop with three. It still has the coloring on it, but it expands like you would in a game on a hitter's chart. So he's going to go fastball, get me over from the windup, breaking ball away. Now, breaking ball away is a beat me. And that's assuming that he's 0-1. If these guys go to 1-0, we go right back to it. So we got to get the strike. We don't start deviating from down the middle till we get that first pitch strike. Doesn't have to be a fastball. Matter of fact, if you're pitch calling and being second guessed all day, yeah. I love going fastball, he's struggling, he can't find it, give him a different pitch. If it's 2-0 and he keeps getting, throw a breaking ball in a 2-0. Throw a breaking ball in a 3-0. If he just can't, and sometimes it helps him find his feet, almost like a shooter that's off, he goes to the free throw line and all of a sudden he goes off. Same concept. So if we work ahead, they understand fastball, get me over, boom, strike one. Breaking ball away, strike two. Breaking ball chase. Now that's called bumped or double bumped. Catcher sets, comes set. As soon as he moves, the catcher pops way out, and we're trying to sweep that breaking ball away, almost unhittable, untouchable. If not, they know we always reroute right back to strike one. Get back in the count, because if you miss here and you come back with that, now you're at 1-1 and you can still get to the 1-2. But now that breaking ball might be more of a get me over. I just don't let them stray out of the white part of the plate that will put us into plus counts for the hitter. Does that make sense? Then we'll just switch and go to some left-handed hitters. We'll go to the wind here. And then we'll go sequence right-handed hitters, stretch, wind, and we'll use left-handed hitters and make them feel, and we try to put our guys in there so that they're tracking pitches and our guys are seeing hitters. So you can see right here, I went through, and this was Nick Leo, so this would have been a sheet for Nick, okay? So he was going breaking ball, get me over on the next sequence, really good breaking ball. Two types, he could just dump it in and he could wipe it out. Then we would jam in. And that's inner third, that's not black, that's trying to get handle off the barrel action. They understand that they're trying to get somebody to hit this pitch. And then if he's 0-2, now he's gonna snap a breaking ball off in the dirt. He's gonna take that to a 1-2, and then we're gonna go to a 44, which was that elevated fastball. So I don't have it on here, but my strike zone, if this is a right-handed hitter right here, I just put an L. So it's outside's a 1, middle's a 2, in is a 3. Now that's the level of knee-high strike. Then a 4 would be right under the hands, a 5 would be under the chin, a 55 would be middle chin, and a 44 would be middle chest. Does that make sense? And just the same for a lefty. 3's on the knee, 1's away, 4's up, 5's chin, 55's middle, 44's chest high. That's where Nick got his strikeouts. So he's setting up eye level to look down. They see it down, and then he's blowing cheese upstairs at 90, 91, sometimes 2. So he just pitched how he was gonna pitch. And the thing that I did, and I didn't even realize I was doing it, I started pitching to the pitcher's strength, and I just really didn't even pay attention to the hitting reports. Maybe he's to a certain degree, loves first pitch fastball, dead red first pitch fastball hitter with big slugging numbers. Okay, I'll pull a string on that guy. But I wanna say, okay, here it is. My guy's good too. And that mentality, which I will talk about at 3, I mean, you're not gonna go back and go, hey man, this guy from Western Sabermetric, he had angles flying around, he's three-dimensional, it's just some pretty simple. And I think pretty simple's good. Back to simplify to amplify. So this is a sequence pin, it's not limited to 3 pitches, they finish the hitter. So we chart it like a game. So they could walk somebody. So it goes from the 1-2-3 now to the sequence, but the sequence will have that guy's name on it. And I construct the pin to the pitcher's strengths. It's not just fastball, breaking ball, changeup. I think about how I'm gonna call his pitches for him. And then I construct the pin for him before we compete with it. So it's custom to the kid. Mastery, 0-2, chase me's, quality ball to set up a 1-2 pitch. My next speech, I think it's at 3, I talk about quality balls. My son's a high school senior. I watch a lot of high school games. Well, I'm a college recruiter. I watch a lot of high school games. And I see a lot of 0-2 pitches that don't do anything to set up the next pitch. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about more of that this afternoon. But the 0-2 pitch is a chase me, it's not a waste me. So it's a quality ball to set up a 1-2, so we'll be working in that. So an example for Nick Leo, the 0-2, oftentimes we would bounce it and come up with the cheese, or we would go cheese up and bounce it. If there's a runner at third, the one out may not bounce it as much, but he loved to come in. So we worked on setting him up. If he was 0-2, we would go that 4 zone and let them feel that, and then snap a beat me breaking ball off in a 1-2 count. And he did it so much that he had memory of what he wanted to do with his stuff. And as we evaluated hitters, let me know on time. I'm completely lost because I'm on Eastern time. 11:05, how much time do I have left? Anybody know? Hour? Great, okay. 1-2 count is beat me. And these are double ups. Just so you know, I'm 51, I've been a head coach for 20 years. I'm a thief, so I know everything Baltimore Orioles are doing in their pitching because I told Keegan to tell me. I want to know. Nick's told me everything the Rangers do. I went out to see Keegan in the Arizona Major League fall game last year. Beautiful out there. Stopped in to see my friend Tracy Smith at Arizona State. I'm asking them, what do? I've asked, think of the biggest school you can think of in baseball. I've talked to that guy. And then think of the next one. And then think of some in this region. I've asked them questions. I want their information, what they're doing. Double up, so that's back-to-back pitches. So, for instance, the guy's struggling with a breaking ball, and he's an around-the-barrel hitter, and he loves that fastball in. We'll work with Nick and our other guys that have that good slider, and we'll double up on that pitch, beat back-to-back beaties. Back-to-back back doors on lefties. Then we'll go to triple ups, which is obvious what it means. So in the mastery pen now, so let's say we're in a 60-pitch workout in January. Start with the preliminary, get him loose, get into the sequence, and then somewhere at the end, we're going to finish out with some mastery work. And then we always finish with a fastball right down his throat. Always. Never finish with a intentional pass, nothing. It's a fastball right down his throat. Triple up, and I got to tell you, I love it. It's just that good. Keep throwing. Make him prove that he can hit it. And I think it's hard to get a tendency chart off of our pitchers now because we're somewhat exotic. We're not by the book. I don't know if you guys know there's a new company out that's circulating stats that you can buy for $5,000 at the collegiate level from all the live streaming that they do of the games. And it can tell you what Minnesota Gopher pitchers do in a 1-2 count with runners in scoring position. What percentage are they throwing this pitch? That's where this stuff is going. It's crazy. And there are four MAC schools that have it. And I'll be passing a tray around for that $5,000 too. But it's the technology, so it's exhausting. And the more I see it, the more I just go, hey, you know what? I don't care. I don't care. Nick's fastball is so good, even if you think it's coming, good luck. There's eight other guys. I think you're going to hit it to one of them. We work on full count a lot. We work on full count competition. So I might say, okay, we're going to go five full counts. You've got to get four of them or you owe me 10 laps. So then I show him the goldfish. So all I need you to do is just have him hit it. Make that guy hit this ball, full count. Because the free bases haunt. We chart free bases. Anything that's six or less, we're in every single one of those games. Anything that's six or over, start getting ugly, 10 or 12, you're absolutely lucky if you win that game. And I mean a hit by pitch, a walk, an error, all those different things that happen. Breaking ball in dirt, we'll work on that if it's that guy. If it's a hard slider guy, I don't do it because of the break of the pitch. If it's a 12-6 dump, we're working on breaking balls in the dirt. We have one guy that's got a changeup so good that we do call the changeup in the dirt. But think of the multi-million dollar hitters that chase that ball. It's crazy. Especially when they're defensive. You rarely see them do it in an 0 or in a 2-0, but when they're down the count where those batting averages favor your pitcher, $5 million hitters. Well, that's actually entry level now. But $100 million hitters swing at that pitch, and sometimes it's 2 feet in front of the plate. So we work on that. And then we work on a pitch out. Our job, recruit talent. Some of you, I don't know, in Minnesota, can you sort of recruit? No, you kind of get what you get? Well, we're recruiting talent. But our biggest job is to prepare talent. It's your biggest job in here. When you, the guys we get are the guys we recruit, now we're trying to prepare them. And then we're trying to motivate them. So as you think of what you're trying to do in here as a coach, I can tell you that I've been a head coach almost 20 years. And this is from the soul a little bit. I played at IU, and Bob Morgan was the head coach there at the time. And I played when Augie Garrido was the head coach at Illinois, and Dwayne Banks was at Iowa. John Anderson was at Minnesota. And he taught me how to compete. He taught me practice structure, and he taught me how to compete. And as I've gotten older within the coaching, and you see how things are going, if you will make sure your guys, your players know that you genuinely care about them, you'll get more out of them than you will by trying to over-discipline them. And I've had to learn that the hard way, just from evaluating myself as a mentor and as a coach and as a teacher, that ultimately I want our players to do well. But even more importantly, they want to do well. It's It's really important for them to perform for us, for their teammates. And I'm not less hard or there's not less accountability. I'm just telling you that I want to motivate a kid. And my arm around that kid, telling him I love him, relax. And I say, hey, Chris, tell me five characteristics about Ryan. I'll go, okay, I'll do it for you. Honesty, is he honest? He is, coach. Is he a great teammate? He is, coach. You trust him? I trust him, coach. Most important word in our program, trust. And I'm trying to make guys feel better about themselves as much as I'm trying to teach them now. It's not that I tried to make them feel bad about themselves before, but I come in, I have a thing now, and I make it visible to myself that reminds me, it's just a little sign, the guys don't even know what it is, but it's to remind me of what my real job is. That's my job. Just inspire those in our care. And teach them everything, but what we get back more, it's like that saying, guys don't care what you know until they know if you care. This is probably more important than any sequence, bullpen, anything that you're doing out there. You love the game, you're passionate about it, so am I. It's probably done a lot for you. You love it in a way your wife will never understand. But this is really the job. We love the people we meet, we love the network, we love big leaguers, pro ball, all of that, draft picks. But this is what we got to do. Help them find the best version of themselves, guys. Just help them. It's just good. It's what we do. It's why we do it. And don't forget, this isn't an attack on you. But I used to blame players when I was dumb. I'm still dumb, but I'm not as dumb. Now that I'm less dumb, our coaches know that we don't say anything about this player. He can't do this. We don't say it. We don't do it. All of our staff meetings are about what can we do with our training and our knowledge to fix what frustrates us and him. Let's design a plan to help that kid. We don't need to. It was about 5 years ago I got away from body language, so I'm one of these guys. And then the players look over, oh no. So they didn't know what to do, so I just went to, you ever see those lawn jockeys and they're holding that light or whatever in people's front yards? So if somebody would make a mistake, like guys would look at me, I'd just go like this. And then I'd say, are they still looking at me? Yep. Still? You're good. Because then I would say, you're not getting anything from me, I'm not going to give it to you. Mature out there, handle your failure, but I needed to help them handle their failure. So I'll wrap on this. I don't know where I am on time, but I'm going to wrap on this. Is now it's not about an error. We tell them we're going to make them, accept it, but let's get ready to not make one back-to-back. Let's be a team and pick the guy up that feels like crap for making it, and let's not ever go two in a row, because we'll live through an error, maybe even two, but it's hard to live through two in the same inning. So we put our focus on what's negative to try to everybody try to help to make it a positive. And you need to believe this. Just in a very confident manner, you have no idea the difference that you make. You surely don't. I don't think I do. I know we're in a special title, we have a special privilege. And for me, this is a special privilege to be at this clinic. Got any questions? I'll take them. Where am I on time?
You have about 10 minutes.
I have about 10 minutes.
11:25.
Okay. So I want to say thank you and good luck to you guys in 2019. I figured there might be some questions on the pens. Does anybody have anything? Yes.
So when you're throwing these structured pens, does the pitch type change at all with what count? Say if the first pitch is a ball, are you still throwing a beat me breaking ball in the next pitch?
That's a good question. I mean, there's no cut way. There's no form that each player does. You're talking about a sequence pen?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's say you're my guy, and you are a plus breaking ball guy and an average developing changeup guy. So first pitch, get me over, we're trying to get ahead. Boom, you're saying if it doesn't happen?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're 1-0.
You're 1-0.
Okay, It depends on the situation. If there is a runner at two and it's a tight game, we might go breaking ball right there and try to get him to hit our 1-0. It depends on the confidence that you have in that pitch and the confidence that I have that you have in that pitch. So we work that guy's strengths. But if you're, I won't throw your third pitch. Does that make any sense?
Yep.
And I won't let that catcher move out of center cut. The point of that plate goes right between you know where. And he sits right there until we get in those favorable counts. But if it's second and third and Eastern Michigan's four holes coming up and he's on fire, that changes everything. Might just put him on now that we don't have to throw the pitches. Or we, if it's this open base runner two, we might go to something else there instead of staying center cut. But ultimately in these preseason pins, I'm creating a mentality that your stuff is good, don't try to nibble. Because when we look back and we evaluate swing and miss percentages too. So in the chart, we're circling it if it's a swing and miss, we circle it, put a Q on it if it's a foul tip. And then we work percentages, like for Nick Leo, that fastball 44 when it was executed, it was a swing and miss percentage of like 70%. And even if he missed it a little bit, it was typically fouled off. So that was his bread and butter that was often set up by the breaking ball in the dirt. Chris Modrinski, the lefty that you saw, that is not his pin. He's coming out in the first, and there's 15 Beagles chasing, sorry, Chris, if you can watch this, chasing those home run balls that just landed in somebody's backyard. He doesn't want to pitch up there at 82, 83. So I build Chris's pin differently than Nick's. And I don't know if you do it, but I didn't. I just said, hey, we're going to go here, fastball, breaking ball. So we were getting work, and it was centered around what's important in throwing strikes. But now the pins have gone to you, the pitcher, your arsenal, and everybody on your staff is completely different. You hardly have anybody that's exactly the same. So at the high school level, I think you're fortunate if you've got a guy that has a three-pitch mix and command of all three. I am. We try. That's what our starters differentiate themselves from relievers because they have a three-pitch mix, command. The relievers are typically two-pitch guys. Okay, did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
First time in row two.
Good question. Sometimes I let the catcher call them. As we get closer to the season, we use on the zone, and then the catcher's got the band, and then I'll call them. So I'll be sitting off by the pen working with the guy, and then I'll call the pitches, and then they'll work on it. Then we'll call pitches with runner at second base. We've got, it's exhausting, but we have like eight or nine different sets of signals with a runner at two because it's crazy how bad guys are trying to steal it. We were on the road last year, and Nick is 91-93, spinning it, it's electric, and he's getting lit up. So it's the second inning, and I asked the center fielder, I said, is there a camera in center field? He said, there is. So now when we go to somebody's yard, we run the field, and we look for the hit track system, look for video cameras. I honestly think that the team we were playing was getting the read with a runner at one or nobody on, and they were communicating it in. This particular place had a video system just inside of the dugout. So we went to second set, and we went to runner at two the entire game, and luckily we had prepared and had nine sets, and all of a sudden they quit hitting. I think he gave up one hit in the next four innings, and he gave up four hits in the first and two runs, including a rocket off the dead center field wall in a count that it shouldn't have happened. So it's a constant cat and mouse. It's kind of unfortunate. Is it trickled into high school? Are they stealing signs at second base? Do you guys worry about that at all? OK. Okay, I'm just telling you, we just spend a lot of time, and you almost feel like activity, don't mistake activity for achievement. I'm just telling you, sometimes it's downtime. It just is, and if you don't practice second sets, if you don't, repetition's the mother of education. You guys all know, we have guys that you tell them one time, and they can go teach it. You tell somebody 15 times, and they're like this. We don't have those guys. But I used to think that was their fault. That's not their fault. That's my job, to teach him different to his need. So I will rep him. So our pitchers, same way, I don't care if they're high aptitude or like me, low aptitude. We're going to rep those secondary calls. We're going to go through his, and we're going to rep it, because reps create confidence. Confidence creates better performance. Better performance creates victories. And it's just, it's all tied into one. Oh my God. Is that it? Okay, well, thank you so much, guys. I'll see you next week.
Thank you.